Welcome to Thiva International Church, to our English worship service. Father God, we thank you so much because your presence is so glorious. For your presence is right here with us, and we are so very, very thankful. Heavenly Father, I pray now that the glory presence of the Lord God will sit upon us, and as you enthrone upon the praises of us, your people, that you would be pleased and that you would lavish all the blessings, all that is concerning your will and all that is concerning what you want to show us in your kingdom and to us, so that we will rejoice and celebrate the goodness of the Lord, and we will celebrate the presence of a glorious King, eternal God, who is forever mighty. Lord God Almighty is his name. And he's so worthy of all of our praises. Hallelujah. Now, in Jesus' name, I plead the blood of Jesus to cover over all the doorposts and the doorframes of our hearts. And the angel of destruction has to pass over. And so God keeps us safe within. And the blood of Jesus is sufficient. And I also welcome you to declare Psalm 100 together with me. Because as we are approaching the presence of the Lord God, we want to declare his goodness. This is a psalm for giving thanks. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God. It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good, and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations. Let's rise together and unite our hearts together, and let's worship the Lord in truth and in spirit. Father God, we thank you for your presence, hallelujah, even as we are entering and just exalting you, that you would be so thrilled to come and embrace your people and lavish all that is about who you are to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Hallelujah. Yes, praise the Lord. Let's worship him. But the name of Jesus.
Thank you. worship you. You are so worthy of all of our praise and worship. There is no God like you. You are the only one true God. Surrender to the Lord, because He is the God who shapes us and molds us. Yeshua, our King, who poured out His life as a living sacrifice unto God, so that we may be born again. Of Jesus' life for our sake. So we pray that we too will pour out our life unto you, Lord, and to worship you in truth and in spirit.
Father, we thank you so much because the glory presence of the Lord is right here with us. So we pray that today you would open our spiritual eyes and you would touch our hearts, that we will worship you in truth and in spirit. This is a very special season and a very special year, the year 2020. The Lord has spoken that this year He has opened up doors for us that no one can shut. Oh, Father, we praise you. We thank you. And as you open up all the doors so that we will go through, we know we are going to go through the year of a great glory. This is the year of greater light and greater glory. Hallelujah. Now, let's take a look at some scriptures. The first scripture that comes for preparing our hearts to sow unto the Lord and to return back to Him His holy tithes. Let's turn to 1 Chronicles chapter 29. 1 Chronicles chapter 29 from verse 9. Yes, as we prepare our hearts to sow unto the Lord, let's stay focused on Him because He is glorious. This is a year unlike any other year. As you draw close to His presence, His glory presence will envelop you. Hallelujah. The people rejoiced at the willing response of their leaders, for they had given freely and wholeheartedly to the Lord. David the king also rejoiced greatly. David praised the Lord in the presence of the whole assembly, saying, "Praise be to you, O Lord, God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and to give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise your glorious name. But who am I and who are my people that we should be able to give as generously as this? Everything comes from you, and we have given you only what comes from your hand. So Father, we rejoice. We come before you. Can we turn to the page for the offering? Father, we are so thankful because you have set your principles to operate on the earth, such that as we walk your principles and put your principles to work, you cause us to increase and to multiply. And you cause us at the beginning of the year to go through the cycles. And for every cycles, for every repeat, the Lord has meant good to come forth. And that you would bring us to be the head and not the tail, the above and not beneath. For those of us who have readied your tithe to be rendered unto the Lord, the scripture says that God will open up the windows of heaven and pour out so much blessings unto us that we don't even have room enough to contain. So in Jesus' name, I speak the blessings of the tithers to come upon the tithers right now. That as the Lord has stationed his blessings, windows of heaven open, the lavishing of God's blessings upon us. Yes, Father God, be pleased to rebuke the devourer for our sake. And that Heavenly Father, you would cause the plantings of our hands to not cast before their time. And so as you rebuke the devourer, our produce will come to fruition. And the nations will call us blessed and call us the land of the Lord's delight. So in Jesus' name, I send forth the word of God to perform now upon every tither in the mighty name of Jesus. And for those who are sowing unto the Lord for free will offering, the principle for free will offering is that as you mete out your seed unto the Lord, according to your obedience to his word, so shall he multiply back unto you his harvest of righteousness coming back to you. With the measure that you measure to him, with that measure, he's going to multiply harvest back to you. 30, 60, and 100-fold. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Now, for those who are writing up a check to Favor International Church, please write the English name only, Favor International Bracket Church. And then you can send it to our mailbox. For those who are giving by e-transfer, the address that you would sow to is our Gmail address, which is favorinternationalchurch@gmail.com. All small letters, all three words connected together, no space in between. So you can send an e-transfer to favorinternationalchurch@gmail.com. And when they ask you for the confirmation, you put the same Gmail address, which is favorinternationalchurch@gmail.com. Then it will be done. And then we will be able to send you a reply to notify you that you have given to the church. Now that you have planted, we are on the increase, which is 30, 60, or 100-fold. You will never be less, because that's the plan of God. Hallelujah. Now, in year 2022, God is speaking to me concerning a few things. Some of the things I will mention here and this time, some of them we're going to discuss them at a later time. So Father God, I pray that your Holy Spirit will come and touch our hearts, and that your Holy Spirit be poured out, Lord, into our lives. Touch us, refresh us, and strengthen us so that we will be able to see, perceive. We will be able to not just to to hear of, but we will come to an understanding. We will come to a place where we go, yes, how come I did not see that before? And now, open my eyes to see, which I think I have not seen before. Because you are able to cause the new to come and the old to pass away. Year 2022, oh Father God, thank you. This is the year of new beginning, and that we can go through realms of glory and doors of glory through Jesus Christ. It is an awesome year. Even though at the beginning it may seem nothing too much is happening, but when it starts, you know, the snowball effect, it's going to be tremendous. So Father God, I pray that you would anoint me to deliver your message, and that you would release your message through your daughter in the mighty name of Jesus. And we give you all the praise, glory, worship, and honor. Amen. Now, we're talking about entering into the new. The first scriptures we need to look at is Isaiah 12 from verse 2 to 6. Isaiah 12 verses 2 to 6. It says here, behold, that means look, be able to see it. God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For Yah, meaning Yahweh, for Yah, the Lord, is my strength and song. He also has become my salvation. Therefore, with joy, you will draw water from the well of salvation. And in that day, you will say, praise the Lord, call upon his name, declare his deeds among the peoples, make mention that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done excellent things. This is known in all the earth. Cry out and shout, O inhabitants of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel in your midst. As we have stepped into the Lord Jesus Christ and embraced Jesus as Lord and Savior, God says, you need to see the new. The new is constantly here, and the old is constantly wearing out. This is the pattern. If you haven't seen it before, you haven't realized it before, you need to know that this is this. You need to declare it to yourself. You say, the old in my life is wearing out. The new is coming to pass in my life. As you have this mentality, you will not delay. You will not procrastinate. You will not just sit things down for yet another day. And you know you need to press on to what's coming ahead, because the new is moving toward you. Why? Because Jesus has died and he has taken away the sinful fallen nature and the entire sinful fallen world and its influence. So then this year we can be totally without that influence. Now that's totally new. For those people who are aware of it and keep moving toward the new and living behind the old, you would find the more you walk, the faster you're going to get. This is also the year of speeding up faster than ever before. So God is going to cause acceleration to take place, because this wearing out of the old and ushering in the new has been happening for a while. And God is saying, I am going to cause this cycle to accelerate. Because as you are able to drop off the past more, the heavy, you know, the flesh, all the heavy substance that dragged you down, that's already wearing out. Remember, do not look back to the old, because this is time to move forward, says the Lord. Hallelujah. He says, four times it says here, behold, God is my salvation. He is the one that comes to save me. Every time you want to move ahead, he is there to save you. Every time you want to make a decision, He is there to save you. Every time you want to make a breakthrough, He is there to save you. I will trust and not be afraid. See, the things that hinder people is still being afraid. I will trust and not be afraid. Meaning, there are some people who still are not sure if they can trust God enough for their breakthrough, or rely on the power of God to believe that, yes, as I rely on Him, I can break through. When the confidence is not there, there is hesitation. Then Isaiah says, I will trust and not be afraid. This is a decision you need to make for this year. Decide to fully trust and lean over, because you know He is good God. Fear can be a crippling thing that would hinder you. But today, in Jesus' name, we take authority over the spirit of fear. We bind and cast it out of you, so that you would be filled with the Spirit of God. The Spirit of boldness, of love, and of sound mind. And here, number two, God has become my salvation. Not just He is my salvation, He is becoming my salvation at all times. Not just He has come to save me, but He will continue to be here to save me and to walk with me until I break through, until I make it through. He has become my salvation. And therefore, with joy. Everybody say joy. Now, this year 2022, the Lord is inviting us to enter into this year with great joy and celebration in our hearts. Because He says, come and draw the waters from my well of salvation. So He has dug a well to put inside of each one of us, so that we will be able to drink from that well at all times. You know, water is essential for living. Not so much food, but water. So God is saying, I have put inside of each one of you a well of salvation. Whenever you may need of the nurturing sap that comes from His life to nurture your life, so that you would live and continue to live and live rejoicing. He says, come with joy, draw your water from the well of salvation. You know, there are some people who say, okay, yes, thank you so much for salvation. They receive Jesus Christ, but then they never use their own effort to take a bucket and to put into the well, to draw the well of salvation. Now, it's not God's fault, but the people of God needs to participate. It is you who would need to take on the promises of God and begin to work the promises of God in your life, so that you may see the results that God has promised you. The difference is, one who is willing to work with the salvation that God has given and drink and keep drinking and keep drinking from the well of life. And the person's life will be every day nurtured, every day being anointed, and every day having more life and having the joy of the Lord in our hearts. That's how it should be. The well is for us. Therefore, engage. Get in there. Hallelujah. And number three says, in that day you will say. Which day? At the day the Lord has established salvation for us. And He did. He has already established salvation by sending Jesus the Christ, who came in the flesh and died on the cross about 2,000 years ago. It is finished, Jesus said. The foundation of salvation is already laid. And for us who pray to receive Jesus as personal Lord and Savior, when Jesus comes in to stay, He comes in to stay for good. And then God would seal the seal of the Holy Spirit inside of us, so that we have the guaranteed deposit of the Holy Spirit inside of us. In that day, you would say, and today we shall continuously say, because salvation is ongoing, is present continuous tense. We are daily being saved by God. Praise the Lord. You see, there are a few things here. Once you receive His salvation, you can't but rejoice, because you know a better end is our portion. God has removed the bad dream of death and destruction. Praise the Lord. Call on His name. Declare His deeds among the people. Make mention that His name is exalted. Sing to the Lord. Cry out and shout. You see, these few things. Praise Him. Call on His name. Pray unto Him. Seek Him and seek His face. Declare, that means proclaim. Proclaim and share about the good things that the Lord God has done all over to those around you. Mention that His name is exalted. Why? Because His name is truly exalted. Sing to the Lord, for He has done excellent things. This is the year we need to engage in salvation, including draw from the well of salvation and begin to drink every day, so that life will fill you. You know, nowadays, people out there, they are so afraid of death. They're so afraid of Omicron. They are living under the shadow of sickness and disease. People are smelling death. But for us in the household of believer, the Lord says, praise. Release praise every day into your atmosphere. Use your own mouth and sing praise to Him, because He is worthy. Live up to a believer who really believe in what the Lord has done for you. As you declare praise, your atmosphere will change. Praise and call on His name. Yes, as you call on His name, people can be saved. As you call on His name, people can be delivered. Declare His deeds. Proclaim and tell it unto others, so that you would begin to create an atmosphere of life around those, to those who are around you. And sing to Him and cry out to Him and shout. Hallelujah. This is what we should do for this year. Now, the second scripture is Colossians chapter 3, from verses 9 to 11. The scripture says, do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here, there is no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. This is also in light of the salvation we have received. Now, since we have already received the new, which is the kingdom of God, God will manifest His kingdom more and more to us this year. It's more tangible, it's more visible, it's deeper, it's wider, it's greater, and He is going to cause His presence to envelop us even more. Because we're talking about greater light, greater glory. So the more you walk toward the new, now you need to forsake the old self. To forsake the old self, there are two things. Number one, stop lying. You know, the lying mentality is one of the fallen sinful nature. And one who continues to lie has for himself Satan, the father of lie, as his, the one he imitate. So do not imitate the devil, who is the father of all lies. Now that we said we are already in Christ, do not lie to each other. Since you have taken off your old self in its practice, and you have put on the new self. Now, the new self means the new conduct that comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. We put on the righteousness of Jesus Christ. The righteous garment of Jesus Christ means actions, behavior, and conduct that is without sin, fully glorious, fully clean. Since we say we have salvation, we have dropped the old, therefore let your action, let your words, let your speech, let what you do, and all the practices that you would do, be putting on the nature of Jesus Christ, so that we will do it according to the likeness of Jesus Christ. So God is calling us like a good soldier, that this year we need to be in this marching order, because we are preparing ourselves for the day of rapture. God will not come and take a group of liars to be, you know, taken up in heaven with him. And if you have a habit of continual lying, you need to know that's from the old self and with the practices of old self, meaning you have fallen thoughts, which is not of truth. But you need to part with it. You need to cut it off from you. You need to die to the old self and put the old self on the cross. And Jesus said this. We know from Mark chapter 8, Jesus did say, he says, take up your cross and follow me. You know, take up your cross and follow me. If you want to follow him, but you don't take up your own cross by nailing your own old self on the cross, Jesus said, you cannot be my disciple. Yes, maybe we should refer to it. Mark chapter 8, I think it's around verse 35. Is 34. Now Jesus called the crowd to him along with his disciples and said, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me and for the gospel will save it. You see, we have been called to identify with Jesus Christ. We are coming in sight of him and to live with him and he with us. Therefore, participate with him. Share in his holy nature. Whoever wants to save your own life, you want to protect your own life, you want to consider yourself being your own master, and you want to do this thing your way, and you want to plan that thing your own way. Now, as you would want to be the Lord and the master of your life, you would lose your life. Because human beings who have used their ownership to make decisions out of their own, that means having man as the center and not God as the center of their reference, they eventually ended up like Adam and Eve, and they fell into deception. They cannot outplay the devil because our ancestor Adam and Eve had fallen into sin. So therefore, no man who by putting himself as the center can be able to overcome the devil. But if you would lose your life, meaning die to yourself, you surrender your life ownership to the Lord, and you ask that God will come and save you, he would come and lead you, and you would want to follow his leading, then do what is righteous in the eyes of God. As you walk on that path, your life would go well. Hallelujah. Let's go back to the PowerPoint. Yes. Now, put on the new self, which is being renewed. See, we are going through this process right now. And God is saying this year, the taking off and the putting on is even more drastic. Because God will give us greater light, therefore greater revelation, and therefore greater glory. So we need to make it to the point where we can follow up to where Jesus is leading us. He says, I'm going to speed this up for you because you are being renewed in knowledge. So we need to take down the old knowledge of the sinful nature. We need to put in the knowledge of truth and continue to walk with it, continue to be trained by it. This new knowledge is in the image of Creator, in the image of the Lord our God. So as we are made in the image of God, we will begin to do things according to the image and the nature of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. The other scripture is Isaiah 43, verses 18 to 19. Forget the former things. Do not dwell on the past. See, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up. Do you not perceive it? I am making a way in the wilderness and streams in the waste land. I realize that this scripture shows up quite often because I think it's the mentality of the people. The mentality of the people is people would love to or have a tendency of going back to the past and make reference to things in the past. But God is saying to us, forget the former thing. Don't even want to remember what had happened before. As things have passed, forgive, forget, let go, move on. Do not dwell in the past. Do not dwell on it. Now, this has to be your own personal decision. If you want to move on to the place of a greater glory and a greater spiritual walk with the Lord God, he is waiting for you. You know, I can see Jesus just standing there at a higher plateau, and then he would walk, and then he would turn back. And then he's seeing you coming along. And then he says, come up here. And then you'll be like, oh Lord, there are these things. What about these ones? What about these other things that's not done yet? But Jesus, ahead of you, he's saying, come up here. Leave those things. Come up here. Now, it's truly up to the person. Everybody say, yield to the Lord. This is your breakthrough point. It's not hard to let go. Because all of our sins, all of the things that happened in the past, are already washed away. There's nothing for you to go back to linger or to hold on anymore. Because Jesus said when he died on the cross, he says, I have taken all your sins, I have taken all your past. You don't have a past. He says, I own your pass. I owned it all. So you want to take the pass and you come to talk to Jesus about it. He says, I don't remember it. And he keeps walking ahead of you and just signaling you and said, come up here. Come up here. Now, he will not come down to where you are because he wants to lead you to come up to where he is. So it's up to you to want to walk and follow him. Hallelujah. He says, see, I am doing a new thing. Every time, the focus, everybody say focus. The focus is one of the most important things. What you choose to focus on will decide your victory, your failure, will decide your ability to win, or will decide the destiny you are going to choose. Here it says, God is saying, I am doing new thing. So if whatever you are focusing on right now, every day, doesn't matter which day, if the thing you are focusing on is not the new thing. Oh, everybody say this. If the thing I'm focusing on is not the new thing that Jesus said he is doing, I better let go of the old thing and I better come and see the new thing. Because you know, what you see, you become. What you see, you identify with. The more you look at this thing, the more you are drawn to it. So make a decision to be drawn to the new. Without sin, totally sin-free environment. Whatever God wants to do is the totally new thing. He says, can you not see it? Father God, I pray that you will open up our spiritual eyes and enable us to see that, so that we may see now that there is a difference between the same old, a rehearsal of the mind and the memory versus the new, which is totally without sin, new reality. Everything that God does is fresh and new. I know as I focus on the new, life will infuse me. That's important. When you begin to focus on the new of God, the sinless, totally new things that God would do, you would begin to breathe life and you would begin to walk in life and you would begin to have life. That is so true. Never focus on the past or the old, because that's taking you back to death, sickness, untimely death. You say, I break from it in Jesus' name. Amen? Amen. And he says, I'm making a way so that you'll be able to come out of your wilderness. I'm making a spring to happen so that you are able to receive my nurturing, so that I will preserve you in the land that is scorched by the sun. God wants to bring us, his people, to a higher and a greater plane, says the Lord. Oh, only the children of God, only that the children of God will be willing to walk in it. Hallelujah. Now, the other thing I want to mention is, we need to go through doors of glory realms. The scripture in Matthew 7, verses 7 to 8. Yes, Matthew 7, 7 to 8. Ask and it will be given to you, seek and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, he who asks and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, the door will be open. Year 2022. The Lord had said, I am going to place before you for Faith International Church and those of us here. He says, I'm going to place before you an open door that no man can shut by the authority of Jesus Christ. What Jesus opened, no one can shut. But what Jesus shuts, no one can open. So ask of him, knock and seek. We need to be doing the pursuing, because God wants to bring us into a level of higher glory. See, God would not compromise his glory. He will not allow his glory to be stooped down to where we are. His glory must be fulfilled by the righteousness of Jesus. And now that Jesus satisfied fully the righteousness of God, then God can put us inside of Jesus Christ and allow Jesus to take us higher. So God is putting very many beautiful things in the glory realms above where we are right now. And he's saying, I need you to do the seeking, the knocking, and the asking. As you press in, and as your desire for me is more and more and more, that can be seen through your action, that can be seen through your pursuit, then you are saying, I'm serious in pursuing you, God. Give me that insatiable hunger so that you would fill me with that hunger, and I will seek you. I will run toward you. Now, this is good. Why? Because God wants to break us off from where we are to move us to a higher realm by constantly drawing us to pursue, to seek, to ask, and to knock, so that we will get there. As you are willing to go further, as you are willing to knock and seek, you are actually saying, I'm willing to let go of the thing before. I'm willing to let go of the things that are lowly. I want to climb up higher. I want to go up higher. Now, this is going to discipline us and shape us so that we will desire greater, holier things. Then, when God sees that your pursuit is bringing you to go closer to that realm he wants you to approach, he will station the greater glory there. Once you are qualified to rise up to be that level whereby you are chucking out things that are not of God, and you say, no matter what, let God be my God, I'm gonna have him no matter what, then you enter into that realm, because now you are able to receive that thing which is even more glorious than before. This is how God would attract all of us his children to follow him. Hallelujah. Let's go back to the PowerPoint. Now, when God wants to bring you into the next realm, you need to find out what timing you are at right now, in the now, and you need to find out what way he has prepared for you to exit the present, so that you're going to go higher with him. Because we are going through doors of glory realms. You want to exit? I mean, we go through the door of Jesus. As we are in it, Jesus provides for us, he shepherds over us, and he leads us to walk in his green pasture and to lie down on the river banks, and he feeds us. And before our enemy, he plays a table, a banquet table, and to give us a cup of blessing that is overflowing. Now, once that season is about to end, God does not want us to stay in one season for the rest of our lives. He wanted us to grow. to seek higher glory and to seek the greater of God. That means to seek the nature of our Lord Jesus Christ. To die to the old self and to be identified with Jesus Christ more. So as we are going through this journey, now, when it's time, how do you know it's time for you to exit? You would notice that it's about time to exit is when your normal daily activity had become so plateau, had become so mundane routine, that you are like very dissatisfied. And you are thinking, no, I'm not satisfied with this, and I don't want to live with this. These are good signals telling you that your season for that period of abundance is about to end. And God wants to open up another season of abundance for you. So when you plateau, when there's no new and things become stagnant, begin to ask, ask the Lord. Now you will also feel the sense of dryness, because as if you don't receive new revelation. The scripture tells us that man eats not by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So we should be eating fresh manna. We should be having new insights. We should be perceiving new things. Hey, look, you know? Yet when you have new discoveries, you become alive. You become alert. You rejoice at the new discovery. Yes, but when there is dryness, you know it's time to step out. Or otherwise, if you don't step out, sometimes God may send you an enemy. God may send you an enemy. Just like David's case. The area where he can step out of being just a shepherd boy was an enemy that is called Goliath. And God needs to equip David in order to kill Goliath. So God would daily send him a bear, send him a lion, you know, and for him to fight and for him to overcome the bear and the lion and to snatch the sheep away from the beasts. And so David was trained in the time when he is at the season of being a shepherd boy. So the Lord is saying to us that you need to be aware of what training he is giving you at the time when you are still where you are. Make sure you fulfill the test and you pass the test. Because right after you are able to overcome all those difficulties and have your faith muscles stretched, then God opens up the door for David. So Jesse the father came to him. He says, David, bring some food to your three brothers who were with King Saul. So he brought food to go to his three brothers. And he went once. And he saw Goliath. Because Goliath came out and he was just defiling the army of the living God at that time. And so David was furious inside. You know, your enemy can point out what kind of a giant you are. Each one of us are made a giant in order to serve the matters of the Lord. If you haven't seen Goliath, you haven't come to that indignation. Just like David, if he is a shepherd boy and he did not see Goliath crying out for war, you know, then he would have been just continuously every day shepherding the father's sheep. Now that he saw Goliath and heard what Goliath said, the giant inside of him connected. So there is a season that includes God may send an enemy to come to you, so that you will need to take on the enemy and have the enemy defeated. Then immediately David is launched into his new promotion. He has never returned back to being a shepherd boy, because now the promotion is he is going to lead the entire nation of Israel as their king. Oh, this is awesome. So do not linger to stay back and be comfortable with where you are right now, but rather make a decision to move on. Be comfortable with the changes that are going to take place, knowing that God is in control. It's not going to be difficult for you. Sometimes God may send a problem where nobody is able to solve. And you would just pray. As you are waiting to find the timing and the way of exit, ask God to use you as some kind of a problem solver, so that you would be able to have the wisdom of God to be at the right place, to be with the right people, and to solve that problem. So God may send a problem for you to solve. You see, David, when he solved a national problem, because Goliath was threatening the entire kingdom, so the reward he got was not just only his promotion with no taxes. He doesn't need to pay taxes for him and his father's house. He can also marry King Saul's daughter, and he got so many rewards, right? Now, whatever God has assigned you to do, it could be two things. One, you could be very happy when you see the problem. Or number two, you could be very angry when you see the problem. For King David, he was highly angry at this uncircumcised Philistine Goliath that is crying out against the name of God. He heard it once, and then he went into the battlefield and he destroyed him. And then he chopped off his head, so that that kind of a harassing thinking will no longer exist in the camp of the believer. It's an amazing thing. So watch for the season and the timing that God has given to you. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 1 tells us that, you know, under the sun, in all things under the sun, there is a proper timing and a proper procedure for all things. We need to ask God to lead us in there and discern, so that we will participate in the timing of the Lord for us. Hallelujah. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. You know, if you do not know how to sit back and look at the events happening around you and see from a higher perspective, you would always wallow back into the same old, same old, same old. A lot of the people of God cannot come out of the cycles of the same old, same old. If you are the one who wants to come out, let's agree and pray. You say, Father God, I don't want to be the same old, same old, same old. I know beginning now and today I can come out of it. I have already wallowed in the same old for so long. I don't want it anymore. I part with it in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, show me. Open my eyes that I may see from a higher perspective. You see, you need to go up higher into the realm of God and stay with God in the third heavens and look down on things. You know, see from God's perspective. And then you would see that it's not good for you to be just involved in the mundane routine, mundane routine, mundane routine. And your years pass, but you have accomplished nothing. Just the same old, same old. No, that's not God's will for anyone. Hallelujah. You say, Father God, take me out. I choose to come out in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, next. PowerPoint. We need to know that year 2022 is also a great season where God will cause multiplication of finances to happen and would come into the hands of the righteous. This is also the year. Yes, because you're going to watch it happening, and God in his righteousness, he is going to come and he's going to shock the world with his presence and with his appearing. People may think that, oh yes, because of COVID-19 and Omicron, oh, you know, everybody is kind of whining and just wallowing in sickness and disease and the fear and the threat of, you know, no work and the threat of this and that. No, that's not the picture of Father God. That's the picture of the earth dwellers who does not have the perspective of eternal God. For us who have the perspective of eternal God, it's not like that for us. Hallelujah. We expect wealth transfer and the ownership of wealth to be ours in the name of Jesus. Amen. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 18. Let's take a look at it. It's for today, and God is saying this. He says, I am the one who gives you the ability. The power means the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms my covenant which I swore to your forefathers as it is today. He says, you know, remember the Lord your God. Don't remember this thing, that thing, this company, that company, this project, that hardship. No. The focus is always on the new. The new means the sinless, without sin environment, without sin truth of God, where God is able to open up everything new to us. You need to receive this. God gives us the ability to produce the wealth, to obtain the wealth. And so he can confirm his covenant sworn to our forefathers as it is today. It is his will that we be blessed, that we be above and not be under. He says, I'm confirming my covenant with you. Do you want to be in this covenant? Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, let's look at the next one. Now, Joshua 5, from verses 8 to 12. This is another thing we need to understand as we step into the new. Joshua 5, verse 8. Because God says, I'm going to cause things to become totally new. And after the whole nation had been circumcised, they remained where they were in camp until they were healed. Then the Lord said to Joshua, today I have rolled away the reproach of Egypt from you. So the place has been called Gilgal to this day. Now Gilgal means to roll away. To roll away the shameful, to roll away the things of religion, to roll away the things that are not from the life of Jesus Christ. anything of sin, which is Egypt. God says, today, I roll all that away from you already. We have entered into the day of salvation. That the well of salvation is already in place in us, so that we can begin to draw the water of life and begin to live from the new. Amen? Yes. He says, the place has been called Gilgal to this day because it means to roll away. If you want to move on to the new, you must roll away the past. Roll it away. On the evening of the 14th day of the month, while camped at Gilgal on the plains of Jericho, the Israelites celebrated the Passover. Passover is a very, very significant concept for putting off the old and bringing in the new. Because Christ has done away with sin. He died and he resurrected, therefore giving us his resurrected life. So we now receive the life of Jesus inside of us, then we should be the new. We should have a new reality. We should have a new way of seeing things. We should have everything new. Don't habitually go back to the old. Hallelujah. So they celebrated the Passover. The day after the Passover, that very day, they ate some of the produce of the land, unleavened bread and roasted grain. The manna stopped the day after they ate this food from the land. There was no longer any manna for the Israelites, but that year they ate of the produce of Canaan. Now, I speak this prophetically over us in Favor Church. Now and this year, in the name of Jesus. Amen. It is an amazing thing. Because it says, after Passover, the washing, the cleansing with the blood. Then, the very day, that very day, they begin to eat the produce of the land. So they are coming into a, you know, the promised land, the new land. They are stepping in. And what they eat is unleavened bread and roasted grain. Unleavened bread means sinless, means without yeast. So they begin to participate in foods that are holy glory. They begin to eat of the Word of God. They begin to have a part in the new life of Jesus Christ. And they begin to eat roasted grain, acceptable form of sacrifice, when the sacrifices have gone through fire. So everything now has become new. And we begin to live a new life toward God. I'm saying this because I see some believers need to part with the, they need to cut out a focus on the past. Yes. Now the manna stopped the day after they ate the food from the land. You know, when they are still in the old mold and the old mindset, God still sent them food coming down to them, yes. And manna is most suitable for them. Where? In the wilderness. But wilderness speaks about the place of temptation. Wilderness speaks about the place where the beasts and the jackals and the poisonous snakes, they can come out and hurt the people of God. So, wilderness place, when the behaviors, when the mindsets of the people are still lingering on, holding on to the old, gossiping about other people, trying to live in the flesh and for the pleasure of the flesh, you remain in wilderness. Manna is the right food there. Why? Because mana means, what is it? It literally means, what is it? So yes, they know it's something which is round, is like, tastes like honey, and is sweet, and God sends every day for them. You know, on the sixth day, God sends a bit more, so they can collect for even the next day. So that the next day, as they keep their Sabbath, they would not need to work, and that they get provided for. But they did even like that manna. And to them, yes, they don't know what it is. So manna is called, what is it? See, God has to keep providing and keep blessing, and yet the people, if their heart is in the wilderness, and if their heart is still having an inclination to the flesh, they cannot see, they cannot think, and they cannot rise up to be at a higher plane to contemplate and to receive the mind of God. Their mind is too dull and too lowly, too under. Yes. But the very day that God will bring his people to come out of the wilderness and entering into the land of Canaan, which is the promised land, manna stopped. And then there was no longer any manna for the Israelites. But that year they ate of the produce of Canaan. Now, if this is the transition time, God is inviting us that we should drop the mindset of lingering, having to say, God, please provide for me. Oh, God, please provide for me. Oh, yes, why are you providing this kind of food for me? We don't like it too much. Isn't that better to be in Egypt? Why are you bringing us to this place where the water is bitter? The constant complaining mindset caused the people to dwell in the flesh and dwell in the past. That must be rolled away. So if you are willing to have it rolled away from you and to say, I come clean and I want to enter into the land of Canaan, which is the land of God's promises, I want to begin to eat the new. Now, when you come in and eat the produce of the Canaan, it means you need to work it out. You need to go and plant. You need to go and harvest. You need to begin to work the principles of God and get the produce that God wants to bless you with by participating in the promises of God. Once you are able to work it out that way, you no longer need to be like a little child and say, God, I don't have this. What should I do? I'm just waiting on you. But you do nothing. That mentality of just that dependence instead of being independent must be broken off from the children of God right now in Jesus' name. Amen. God is expecting us to mature. You know, Hebrews chapter 5, the last two verses. Hebrews chapter 5, the last two verses. Anyone who lives on milk, being still an infant, is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness. The reason why the people are in the wilderness is because they are not familiar with the ways of righteousness, the holy way of doing things, the godly way of doing things, the responsibility to do, to think, to speak what is right, and to take it upon yourself, and to speak and to do and to will what is right in the eyes of God. See, it's a personal choice. Jesus himself, he wanted to follow God and he wanted to obey Heavenly Father. And so he chose to pray unto the Lord God and relied on God and say no to things that would want to take him off course. See, anyone who lives on milk only, which is just the very basic of salvation. You know, we get into the realm of the kingdom of God through salvation. As we pray to receive Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior, we have the foundation of salvation. But we need to move on from there. It's like once you are being born again, you are like a little infant baby. You cannot be eating solid food. But now that you have been drinking milk for a time, see, God delights in his children to mature. There's no parents that would love to have their baby forever in the baby form. It will be a scary thing if the baby does not grow. You know, if the baby is stunted in the growth, it will be a great sorrow for the parents. So God does not want any one of us to keep drinking milk. So he wants us to begin to flex the spiritual muscles of faith so that we can be acquainted with the teachings of righteousness, that we will by the Holy Spirit discern what is right and what is wrong and choose to do what is right. But solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. So this is the year, brothers and sisters, this is truly the year. And you know that principle in Matthew 18, from verses 18 to 20, Jesus said, he says, I've given you authority to bind and to loose. So as even two shall agree as unto a thing, my Father is going to answer your prayers. So here we have the principle of two, and two as agree unto a thing. I tell you the truth, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, I tell you that if two of you on earth agree about anything you ask for, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three come together in my name, there am I with them. Now, year 2022 carries a lot of twos in it. We know one of the two is this: as two shall agree as unto a thing, and as we pray unto the Lord, he is going to grant us. And God is saying, he says, this is the year. I even fix it into the year that as you ask me, I'm going to grant it to you. And then there is also the principles of 22. We know from Isaiah 22:22, God says, I have put my kingdom government upon the shoulder of Christ Jesus. And what he closes, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open. I will place on his shoulder the key to the house of David. What he opens, no one can shut. What he shuts, no one can open. I will drive him like a peg in a firm place. He will be a seat of honor for the house of his father. You know, the name that was used here, I should make a reference to it. It says here, my servant Eliakim, son of Hilkiah. The meaning of Hilkiah is Yahweh's portion. The meaning of Eliakim is resurrection. My resurrection. And God is saying, I have put, understand this, Yahweh's portion and my resurrection. And so God is saying, He says, I will place on Hilkiah, meaning on my resurrection, the key to the house of David. When Jesus died and resurrected, surely any door He opens, no one can shut. Because He can also come into hell and He can be resurrected from the dead. Even hell and Hades, the devil and death, cannot cage Him down. So the door that's open through the name of Jesus, no one can shut. And the door that through the name of Jesus, when He shuts, no one can open. See, it says, what He opens, no one can shut. What He shuts, no one can open. He says, God says, I have already driven Jesus into that firm place. Remember when Moses was talking to God and he wanted to see the glory of God. And God said, Moses, you come here. There is a place near me. You stand on the rock. The rock means revelation. It means the foundation of salvation. And God says, I am going to make a cleft in the rock. I'm going to strike on the rock. So Father God has decided to strike on the rock, to put Jesus to go up on the cross and die for the sins of the world. And He did die for our sins. And by His death and resurrection, we can now come and be put in that firm place. That firm place which is near God, with the crack of the rock of ages there, and God hide us in the wounds of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will be a seat of honor for the house of His Father, because now God is able to hang everything on Jesus, the resurrection. Now all the glory of His family will hang on Him, His offspring and offshoots, all His lesser vessels, from the bowls to all the jars. In that day, declares the Lord God Almighty, the peg driven in the firm place will give way. Now, there was a peg that was driven in the firm place before, when people have sinned against God. It is the law. The law, and only the law, can be so firmly anchored there at a place near God. And when that law is there, it's detrimental for us. Because every time we approach God, the law would say, you have sinned, you have sinned, you have sinned. But now, that peg, God says, I'm going to take it out. I'm going to exchange it with Hilkiah. I'm going to put the new one there. His name is Resurrection. That's the Lord Jesus Christ. He who is able to come and give us salvation. Oh, hallelujah. The peg driven in the firm place, which was the law, now can give way. It will be sheared off and would fall. Everything that was hung on the law before was for the display of shame. None of us will have any glory as we are hung up there by the law. We can never escape. But thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ, God has come and He says, I have replaced that peg with this one, with a new peg. Hallelujah. Yes. I will drive him like a peg into a firm place. He will be a seat of honor for the house of his Father. So all of us now inside of Jesus Christ, because he died and he resurrected and now seated at the right hand of God. I mean, he's at that exalted place and he hangs us all up there so that we can display the glory of God, that our sins are forgiven and that we now have a future. Oh, hallelujah. We are gloriously safe. And there's no shame, there's no condemnation with us, and God is amazing. Hallelujah. Let's go back to the PowerPoint. Now, there are a few other things I want to mention before we close. Yes. The first one is Job 29 verse 6. This is the scripture that the Lord has given to me. Job 29 verse 6, in particular for this year. It's a powerful, powerful scripture. When my path was drenched with cream and the rock poured out for me streams of olive oil. You know, there is an abundance we need to arrive at. Don't settle with the mundane in the same old, same old. We need to arrive at this. It says, that's the place Job had encountered this. He says, God had put me in that place. So we pray. As God shows me the scripture, I say, Father God, bring me to that place. Bring me, my family, the whole favorite church to that place. Drenched with cream. Cream means the fatness of all the abundance of his goodness and of his provision. So that we will inherit this as our portion. And the rock poured out for me streams of olive oil. We know, you know, when it was Moses' time, God asked him to speak to the rock. And water gushed out. But here is not water. Here is oil. Here is oil. It means the anointing. You know, once you are anointed with the anointing, you are like in an atmosphere where you are totally engulfed, totally covered up. You know, when thick oil is poured upon you, and cover over the entire you, there's no other outside oxygen or outside thing that is able to come in to where you are. That means the anointing of God is going to seal you within from any influence that comes from the external world. And God says, I'm going to cause you to walk in this manner every day, day in and day out of your life. And he is saying, with the anointing oil, even if your enemy wants to come and catch you. You know how you want to catch a live fish, you know? Just caught from the bucket. And you stretch out your hand and you try to catch the fish. It was so slimy and slippery, right? And then you thought you're going to get the tail, but then it's going to be so slippery. And it slipped away. In the same way, God is saying, I'm going to cause every enemy that wants to come and snatch you or take you by surprise or do whatever harm to you, they shall be no wise able to make it. Because I'm going to cause you to be so slippery, you're going to shoo, and slip away. You're going to be so lubricated, and then they couldn't find you. They thought they had you, but they cannot have you. So this is the true picture that God gives to us for Favor International Church, for me and for the church and for us who believe. Amen. Hallelujah. So he says, I'm going to give you the best that you may enjoy. You will come and feast in the abundance where I have stationed up there for you. But remember, don't stay under. Come up higher. Come up higher. Come up higher. As you make your way to come up higher, you will gradually die to the flesh. It means Gilgal. It means rolled away. You need to leave that place of shame. You need to move away from Gilgal and roll away your shame and begin to enter into the promised land and take hold of the promises of God and begin to live fully able to enjoy the abundance that God has given to you. Hallelujah. Now let's look at Job 28. Verse 7. No bird of prey knows that hidden path, no falcon's eye has seen it. Proud beasts do not set foot on it, and no lion prowls there. Now, this is powerful because God is saying, I'm going to bring you up to hide yourself in myself. This is the year God says, come and hide yourself a while with me. You need to stay rested. You need to stay with the Lord. At the same time, come and hide away. Because he says, this is the place of refuge. This is the place. It's called a hidden or a secret place. No bird of prey knows that secret hidden place. Even the way, who is the Lord Jesus Christ, of how he moves about and how he brings us to maneuver, the bird of prey cannot see it. No falcon's eye had seen it, because faster and greater and more effective are the ways of the Lord God, far beyond any birds of prey can arrive to. Proud beasts speaks about those who are, in particular, the devil, the demons, the cohorts, and also sons of perdition who work together with them. Proud beasts do not set foot on it. No lion prowls there. Why? Because they had not noticed that place. Remember, it is in Jesus Christ that no demonic anything will be able to get near to him. So as we apply the blood of Jesus Christ to cover over the doorposts and the doorframes of our heart, the angel of destruction will also have to pass away and to leave us alone, because they cannot penetrate through to where the blood of Jesus is. So remember to plead the blood of Jesus to cover over the doorposts and the doorframes of your heart. Hallelujah. The other thing I want to mention, we're going to look at the PowerPoint soon. This other thing I want to mention is this year, 2022, it's about the year of squirrel. What I want to say is there's something interesting about this year. Because for the year of squirrel, it means squirrels around the winter time, they would like to hibernate, you know? So they would want to, they just come into that mode where they would naturally wanted to feel sleepy. And so they reduced their activities in the winter, and then they went into the hole for hiding. And once they got into that mode, they don't wake up until that whole cycle was over. And so what the Lord is showing me, there is wisdom in this. is that this is the year where we need to have a good rest. Now, we are not like squirrels where we need to hibernate, but we need to sleep. We need to rest. So we need to, number one, keep Sabbath rest. As we keep Sabbath rest, then we are actually saying, can we go back to the PowerPoint? We're actually saying, God, I'm trusting in you. Every day of my life, I know, I'm going to this. Yes, I want to mention this to close actually. God is saying to us, he said, this year, as we come into Sabbath rest, we need to stay rested. So do your works for 6 days. On the seventh, make sure you don't try to make ends meet with your effort. Even if you don't know how and what, let go and rest in the presence of the Lord. You are showing to God that you trust Him to direct your future, and you trust Him as the provider for your future. That's very important. So when you come to the rest time, now there are two cycles here. One is the repeat. The repeat means things happen again and again and again. So sleep, when you enter into rest every night, make sure you have a good sleep. And make sure you sleep sound and well, and stay rested in the Lord. And make sure every week you keep your Sabbath day to honor the Lord. Now, the second cycle, that's also a repeat, is when you wake up, it's already the dawn, it's already the bright daylight, where you can begin to do work. And so God is saying, stay rested when you sleep. And then, once you wake up, begin to focus on the new. Begin to do what God says is the new. And do not remember the old. Whatever you have not done before, do it. As you repeat these cycles in your life, from beginning of the year to the end of the year, you have 365 days. Every day, you are actually circulating. You see? You are circulating yourself. But if you, in the work, in the wake time, you are beginning to choose to do the new. As long as it is daytime, then you are moving far ahead of many other people. Every day when it comes, one day you move a bit higher than the others now, because you choose to do the new. The second day, you choose to do another new. And as you go the same, like a repeat cycle, you are actually moving higher and higher and higher and higher into the realms of the new, says the Lord. Yes, work with the repeat. We need to be like the almond tree. The almond tree is the first tree of awakening that comes to realize that winter is over and spring is coming. It's always the almond. That's why almond, you know, the staff of Aaron is the almond staff, is used as a symbol of first awakening or resurrection. Because we need to be the ones who wakes up first. You know, prophets knew ahead of time. They don't get to know the case only after everybody's there. Before anyone would know of it, the prophets would hear from God, and they would know what it is, and then they're going to come and warn the people. In the same way, God is saying, stay with working on the new only for every waking hour. And he says, be like the almond, budded almond resurrection. As you begin to step out in the new, you are launching into an arena where no other people had gone before. And you would excel and you would go beyond and far, far, far beyond those that are of your age and of your time. Hallelujah. Oh, Father God, I thank you. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus right now. Thanking you, Lord, you have given us the tools to move ahead. And surely we will be able to move ahead because of what you have shown us. And thank you that you have given us the authority that what we bind, no one can loose. And what we loose, no one can bind. Because it is the authority in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Father God, we just, in Jesus' name, I speak the release of a wonderful year, 2022, to come upon us at Favor International Church. That you would touch our hearts, Lord, to begin to perceive and to begin to do the new. That your zest, that your love and your passion in the Lord Jesus Christ fill us. Fill us, Heavenly Father, with your love so that we will be able to partake in the new and do what is the new. I know that each one has a different calling and different sets of gifts. I pray in Jesus' name that as your people are seeking your face to find out what this year each one should be doing, that you would show them clearly, without a doubt, how you are leading each one accordingly. Because you said, my sheep knows my voice. Lord Jesus, we come to surrender to you. We pray that you would continue to lead us and to shepherd over us, even at Favor International Church. That you would increase the works of glory in our hands. And that you would increase greater lights so that we can see more, and that we receive more revelation, and that we can enter into that glory realms of God. Thank you, Heavenly Father. And I command angels to come forth to help us in our way also. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's worship the Lord together. Hearts, and let's receive his benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and grant you his shalom, peace, in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Alleluia. Praise the Lord. The Lord is mighty and the Lord is awesome. Believe in the message and work it out in your life. You will end up at a place you never know before. Hallelujah. We have two announcements. The first one is every Thursday night at 7 p.m. we have a bilingual healing and deliverance service. It's called the Hour of Victory. You're welcome to come into that hour where Jesus Christ has already conquered and has already caused the river of life to flow and the river of healing to flow. Come and experience that reality. The second announcement is Insights for the Week. So every Saturday, I'm going to do a recording about what Father God has put in my heart, and then I'm going to share with you, and then we're going to pray, and we're going to line ourselves up with the Word of God until rapture. So before we see you next time, remember to plead the blood of Jesus over the doorposts and the door frames of your heart. The angel of destruction has to pass over. Do not fear, only believe and rely on the blood of Jesus. So expect the good of the Lord. We're going to see you next time. Remain in great health.